Morning, everyone. We are the frozen chosen today, aren't we? Good morning. You'll have to speak up. It'll warm it up in here. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to worship at St. John's. I am so thankful that we are able to be here today. We didn't get frozen out or anything. And so welcome into our sanctuary, and it's warm, and a special welcome to those who are joining us online from the comfort of your home. The weather outside is indeed frightfully cold, but I trust and pray that the Holy Spirit will warm our hearts today and encourage us as we encourage each other. Today, I'm going to give you a heads up. We're going to talk about something that's a little bit uncomfortable. Now, the topic itself isn't something that's necessarily uncomfortable to speak about. There's not a hot button issue, or it's not going to make you kind of squirm in your pew hoping that we don't have a disagreement on something. But it's an experience that sometimes makes us a bit uncomfortable. And that experience is silence. Sometimes silence can feel a bit awkward or uneasy, but sometimes there's also comfort in silence and peace in silence. And so as we think about silence and about listening today, we know that that God speaks to us in these quiet moments as we remember the story of the calling of Samuel, and that's what our focus for today. A couple of announcements. For you, our outdoor event's being moved indoors today. We've got a minus 17 wind chill. So that's, I must be getting old. That's too cold for me. But we're really excited. And I want to thank everybody for their help today. You're preparing things, getting things ready. You're just your prayers today. We've got a really great group that's coming, and everybody that's coming is returning. They've either been to one or both of our previous events for families, and they're coming back. And so this is an encouraging sign, and it takes time to get to know folks, and that's what we're doing. And we can really see God at work through this, and look forward to sharing with you what happens at the Grimsby Winter Games. I figure the football game in Buffalo got postponed today, so we're just going to move it in under the dome here today. Also, Reverend Maria sends us her love today. It's a little snowy and well, and so she wasn't able to be here, but there's some information about the prayer wall at the back of our sanctuary, and that's a new addition this year, and she'll be able to speak to that a little bit more next week. But we're really excited that as we begin a new calendar year, that we can really shift our attention to prayer, to prayer for folks in our church family, or folks that we are connected to in our church family, for things in our world, for situations in our community. It's so important to pray, and we've got a wonderful tool that we can use for prayer. Also, if you were not able to pick up your offering envelopes last week, they are in your mailbox. They are available. If you know that there's someone else that's not able to get out and you see their envelopes, please pick them up and deliver them to them. And also, we're thankful Johanna has prepared the tax receipts for us, and those are available today as well. And we really are thankful for her hard work on getting these documents together for us. It takes a bit of time and energy to do that, and we're really grateful for the way in which she helps us out. Let us take a moment now to quiet our hearts and minds before God as we continue our time of worship. That's okay. We're going to have the call to worship first. Let's say this responsively. God, you call each of us to serve you, and we answer, "Here I am." Jesus, you call each of us to follow you, and we answer, "Here I am." Holy Spirit, you call each of us to worship you this day, and we answer, Here I am. Let us pray together. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of community, the gift that we can come together and be together in all circumstances, in all situations, because you are faithful to us. Jesus, we thank you for your example of faithful love that's committed to each one of us individually, but also to us as your body, the church across the world. God, we thank you that you continue to speak to us. Lord, we pray that today we would be encouraged to find the ears, our spiritual ears, to tune into you, to listen to what you have to say, Lord. Help us to learn to walk a little slower, to speak a little quieter, to think a little bit longer, and to find comfort in the silence. Find comfort in your presence. God, sometimes we just want to go and do our own things. Sometimes we just talk and talk and talk, and everybody talks, and it feels like we don't always listen to each other. We don't always listen to what you're trying to tell us, Lord. Lord, for the times when we haven't listened at all, or maybe we haven't listened as closely as we need to, Lord, we ask your forgiveness, because sometimes that can certainly cause some pain or sadness or hurt. God, help us to live out your forgiveness. Help us to live peaceably. And help us today to listen to your Holy Spirit. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Let us now stand together and sing. If any kids want to come forward for our story time. something, not special, something that I use pretty much every day. A lot of people use these quite often. What are these, Ella? They're headphones, and you have some at school too that you use sometimes if you're doing something on the computer at school. And what do headphones do? What do headphones help us to do? Yeah, that's right. Helps to hear on the computer. They help us to hear things a little bit clearer. And these headphones are special too because the way that they're shaped, they help to kind of block out some of the other noise that's around. So these are really good for listening to music on, or a lot of times when we're doing the church services from home, I would use these to try and get the sound of the audio to sound as good as I can. It was a work in progress, wasn't it? But I think we got there. Headphones do help us to listen really, really closely and clearly to what we want to tune into, what we want to pay attention to. Today, we meet someone in our scripture from the Old Testament. So that's the part of the Bible that is the story of God's people before Jesus was born. And before Jesus was born, and there was a little boy, and he was born, and his name. Yeah, they are. You want to see them? Oh, cool. And there was a little boy named Samuel. And Samuel, his mom wanted him to know what God wanted for his life. And so Samuel, when he was very little, he went to live at the temple, which is kind of like the church, but with the had a temple. And he lived with a priest named Eli. And one night, Samuel was lying down because it was bedtime, and he heard a voice calling his name. And thank you. And the voice said, Samuel. And Samuel got a little bit confused because he thought it was Eli that was calling him. And it took three times before Eli realized that it was God trying to talk to Samuel. And so we know that God talks to us today in a lot of different ways. And I'm going to ask of your grown-up friends, what are some ways that God might talk to us today? We might hear something in our ears, but that doesn't always happen. But what are some ways that God might talk to us today? What do we think?
Answered prayer,
yeah. We pray and God helps us out or gives us an answer to that prayer. That's one way God talks. What else does God talk to us? Oh boy. Well, God talks to us through the Bible, through when we read God's word in the Bible, and sometimes we'll read things that really make sense about what's happening in our lives, and we can see God speak to us. Or sometimes we think about all the things that the Bible has said, and we're in a situation where things are a bit tricky, or things are going really well, and we can see, that makes sense for what this part of the scripture says. So God talks to us through his word. God also talks to us through the conversations that we have with other people as we learn from each other. And a lot of our seniors, when we have chair chat, that's a wonderful time that we learn from each other, isn't it? From our experiences and from God's life. And today, when we get together with our families, we're going to do some sharing and talking and maybe hear a little bit about what God has to say for us. So there's lots of ways that God still talks to us today, but it's really tricky for us to be able to listen and to take out all those things that distract us and tune in and listen closer to God. So let's come before God, and let's talk to God, and we'll pray, and let's I'll lead and you can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for speaking to us.
Thank you for speaking to us.
Help us to listen.
Help us to listen.
To be patient.
To be patient.
And trust in your words to us.
Trust in your words to us.
We pray these things in Jesus' name. And together, we're going to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us when he prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now we're going to sing a song that I think you know, and it's about how we need God in all situations. So let's stand and sing to God together.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Seated. And at this time, I'd like to invite Helen to come forward and read our scripture to us from 1 Samuel chapter 3.
Good morning. The scripture reading today is taken from 1 Samuel 3, 1 to 20, and can be found on the screen. Samuel's calling and prophetic activity. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and he lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up, went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not know yet the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore, Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by service or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son," he said, "here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you to do? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also, if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. So be the word of the Lord.
The first instrument that I learned to play, somewhat decently, I guess, was the piano. I mean, eight years of lessons, I should have learned something, right? And the piano was a good foundation for me to figure out how to play other instruments and understanding sort of the theory of music and how all those things work together. I don't remember too many of the pieces that I learned in those years. I mean, it was 25 years ago, and I really haven't played them since, so can you blame me? But there was one piece that I remember learning about, and I would like to share, actually. This is a piece that's in three movements, and I'd like to share the first movement with you now. It's a piece, and it's called 433. It's written by a guy named John Cage, and I think it ties into what we're doing. So if you'll indulge me, I'll play it. The first of the three movements.
Thank you. If those that don't know, John Cage was a bit of an avant-garde composer. And the song 433, it's 4 minutes and 33 seconds long, and it's silence. There's three movements. And if you look at the sheet music, it's all rests. That's all it is. But the purpose of the piece is really to listen to things that are kind of things that are not musical noises. Whatever the environment is, that's what the song is. And so it's sort of one of those food for thought pieces, and certainly I think probably any one of you could play it if you wanted to as well. A question for you. Did you hear what you expected to hear? No, you were probably thinking that I was going to play something. I mean, I guess I lifted the lid and there was a bit of sound there. I mean, there's three movements in the piece, and it's literally the lid moving up and down to signify each of those movements. So maybe some of you were a little disappointed in what you heard. Maybe some of you were very thankful with what you heard. I don't know. But it reminds us that sometimes in life we have to expect the unexpected. When we meet Samuel, the first two chapters of 1 Samuel tell the story of his mother Hannah and how she was barren. She was not able to have children. This was a great difficulty for her because she wanted to have children. Now, her husband at that time had two wives. That was one of the things you did at that time. 1 Samuel lands in our Bible after the book of Judges. And really, to sum up the book of Judges, it's these people that are appointed by God to judge the nation of Israel, help them with their disputes, help them with their decisions. But as the book of Judges goes on, the nation of Israel and the society just slowly decays and becomes more and more immoral and destructive and really wandering away from what God is calling them to be. And so there's this incredible brokenness among God's people when Samuel is born. And for many years, Samuel's mother just couldn't have children, and to the point where she was being mocked and insulted by her own family because this wasn't happening. And through years and years and years of prayer, Hannah finally did have a child, and she promised God that if she were to have a child, that she would give him to the Lord. And so at the age of three, Samuel goes to live with Eli in the temple. Also, we learn and hear this sort of unfolding later on in Samuel's message to Eli, that Eli's the priest and his sons are kind of co-priests with him. The sons do some terrible things. They steal from the Lord. They steal offerings. At that time, they would have animal sacrifices, and they would take the best part of the sacrifice for themselves. They even went so far as to sexually assault some of the women at the temple, and Eli didn't rein them in. He didn't say, "You can't do that." He didn't say, "That's not of God." He just let it go. And so that's sort of why, at the end of the passage that Helen read for us today, why God spoke against Eli and his family. God had had enough of the decay and the ruin. But before we get there, we're confronted with a few things. First of all, Samuel hears God, and it's really the challenge of hearing divine messages. I don't know about you, but it's really not really all that often that we hear stories today, especially in our Presbyterian circles anyway, of people
hearing an audible voice from God. Sometimes it does happen, and there are a couple stories that folks have shared with me around here at St. John's of significant moments in their lives where there has been almost a voice speaking to them or guiding them or causing them to pause for a moment. And they're very powerful stories, but it's not something that typically for a person to experience that every day. And at that time, since the nation of God, Israel, had wandered so far away from the Lord, we read that that divine messages were very rare. Visions were extremely rare in those days. It was a very dry and difficult season for the people of Israel. And so for Samuel, at such a young age, to get a message from God really is incredible, really is remarkable. Find it interesting in verse 2 of our passage, it says that Eli's senses had dulled. And it makes mention that his vision was going. And there's some debate among scholars of whether, you know, maybe this was the sign of a man in his older years. And of course, that happens. But also wondering if that's sort of metaphorical and that people at that time were not listening for God. It's not that they weren't listening to him. They weren't even expecting that he was going to speak. And it takes Eli the priest, the man of God, the guy who is really the spiritual leader of the nation of Israel, it takes him three times to realize that God is speaking to Samuel. You would think, I mean, I'm not one to evaluate colleagues. I shouldn't do that. But one would think that certainly somebody in that high of a position would know that the boy was hearing God's voice. It takes him three times to hear that. But I think this dulled senses, and if that's in the spiritual sense, really mirrors the people of Israel at that time and their willingness to listen and obey and follow and tune in to God's messages. But as Samuel is called and he has to give the bad news, it's one thing to give bad news, but it's another thing to give really bad news to your boss, isn't it? Think back to your working days, and could you imagine walking into somebody's office who has a lot of seniority over you and says, by the way, you're getting fired. That's really not a position for a subordinate to come in and share that message. But that's sort of what happens. Samuel, he hears this message about the end of Eli and his family's time as priests of Israel, and he has to give them the news. And you can tell he's dreading. He doesn't want to say it because he's afraid of what will happen. The scripture says that he is afraid to say it. But there's this relationship that's developed between Eli and Samuel where he knows that he has to say it, and he does, and Eli realizes that what God is saying will happen to his family is just because of how they've wandered away and gone, not just wandered away, but they've gone against what God is all about and what God's people are to be and the complete brokenness that's there, but he also realizes that God is good and that he's calling Samuel. And there's a tectonic shift, it seems, in the people of Israel, because Samuel is really the last judge that's there for the people of Israel. We read about that. But also he grows in his faith, and he grows in his stature, and he becomes a priest as well. He becomes Eli's successor. And sort of in his time of leadership, he warns the people of Israel, who are really pestering God for a king, pestering God that they would be just like other nations and have their own king. And Samuel says, I don't know, this is a great, these monarchies, and they're not really the greatest things. They send people down wrong pathways. That's sort of Samuel the judge talking. But Samuel's really faithful to his call and faithful to his relationship with God, because as the priest, Samuel does something that I think he believes is against his own judgment, but it's what the people want, and God decides to give them two kings, the first two kings of Israel, and Samuel anoints them. So Samuel is an incredible figure in the history of Israel, and he's sort of this linchpin that marks this transition from this time of decay and brokenness into a time where there's some stability, and certainly we know the ups and the downs, the good behavior and the sinful behavior of the kings of Israel, because they're people just like you and I. But Samuel's life and ministry is sort of that linchpin that moves Israel into that time of a monarchy. And I think we might see some parallels between the time of Samuel and our time today. There is incredible disruption in our world and disunity in our world. And I think there's an incredible amount of disunity among Christians in terms of some of our points of theologies and some of the differences that we have, the different ways that we have of interpreting the scripture, not just interpreting them, but applying them to everyday life, applying them to family structure, applying them to the treatment of those who are poor, to the treatment of those that are born a particular gender, or who declare their sexual orientation one way or the other. And there's incredible disunity on that and across, certainly in the church in the Western world. There's a lot of chaos, and we see and we hear a lot of lament about the way and the reality that church is not what it used to be. That church is different, and boy, we must be doing something wrong or something bad. If all these people, how do we mess it up that there's, you know, this great exodus? And I think if we're being honest and we're looking at our congregation, we're one of thousands in North America and in the Western world that have seen that decline, that have seen that maybe that loss of direction, or have felt that spark of following the Holy Spirit in a new direction, and we're so stuck on hanging on to some of the things, the vehicles that we use to express the meaningful relationship that we have in Christ, that we miss the essence of our relationship with Christ. I wasn't here for the good old days. It was before my time. I hear stories of these incredible faithful people doing wonderful things and sharing the gospel in incredible ways. And in their time, they were being faithful to who they believed Christ was calling them to be. And I think we need to celebrate that, because we're only here today because we stand on the shoulders of the generations who have come before us. And we are so blessed to have people that have stayed with this church for 50, 60, 70, 80 years, 90 years, I think, is our longest standing member. Over 90 years, someone that's been here. That's incredible. But I think to look at what we're doing now in our congregation, and what many other churches are trying to do, they realize that it can't just be the same old thing that we've always done. And we can't just copy the roadmap from the church up the road or from the church two towns over because it worked for them. We need to learn from each other and authentically be able to express who we are as God's people, who we are as disciples of Christ in this community to which we are called. And I think if we look back on the olden days as an evaluative time and as the measuring stick for today, I think it's looking at a church in two different cultures, in two different communities. Grimsby used to be a town of 1,500 people. Now we're a town of 25,000. That's a huge shift in population. That's a huge shift in diversity. That's a huge shift in the DNA of the Grimsby community. And the people that served back then and have continued to serve today, there's a faithful presence that's there. But I think if we're going to measure one against the other and say one was better than the other, I think we run into the risk of being very disrespectful to the faithful presence that we find in the people here today. They're two different communities in two different times, with some of the same folks carrying that faithful witness and reminding us day after day and week after week, not what we did or how we did it, but reminding us of why we did it, because of who we are in Christ. We remember that St. John's, we've agreed about 5 years ago, and then we reaffirmed that in the spring, that St. John's is Christ-centered and community-focused, that St. John's seeks to build relationships by teaching others and sharing the gospel in practical ways. We are called, we've agreed a couple of times over, that we are called as a community to know Christ and to share his good news with all people. That's who we are. And that's a blessing. There's just different ways of expressing that and different ways of being faithful in that. That being said, wherever one is in their own personal spiritual life, it's always a challenge, especially this day and age, to pause and to listen for God's voice. What's God's voice telling us? What's God's voice communicating to us? And I want us to try an exercise. And we will intentionally listen. I'm not going to pull a fast one on you and say it's a song and it's not. But I want you just to sit for a few seconds and listen to the sounds that you hear around you. Let us listen deeply to our surroundings. Did we hear anything? It was pretty quiet, but were there any noises that kind of stood out a little bit or were buried in the background? What did we hear?
Fan and the projector.
That's right, the fan and the projector, they're always going. What else did we hear? The rad, that's right, the good old water heater. Give us a little ping and near the end, a big pop. I was hoping that would happen because that. Anything else that we heard? That's right, there were some cars on the road outside. That's right. I heard a couple of the pews kind of creaking as they always do. These 95-year-old pieces of furniture, they're just going to groan with the heat and the cold, aren't they? So there's always these sounds that are present in our lives in our time of worship and in this place, and maybe some of the sounds are bring a bit of familiarity to the environment. That there's just some things, we don't really listen to them, we don't really pay attention, but they're always there. And friends, I think the truth that is important for us to remember today, that one of the critiques I think of Christianity today is that some might say, well, we don't really have any prophets today. We don't have anyone really speaking like they did, like in the days of good old Samuel. And all we have today are people that are preaching or interpreting what Jesus said and trying to apply it in certain situations. And to that I would say that God is continuing to speak to us. Just like all those little noises that we hear, the cars and the fan and the projector and the rad and the creaking pews, they're always there. And I don't believe that God has stopped speaking to his people. I think it's that sometimes we forget to stop and intentionally listen to what's going on. And so as we leave today and we continue with our art of noticing the world around us and the art of trying to be mindful and be present during this season of Epiphany, I want you to go this week on a sound hunt. That sounds like a funny thing to do, is it? A hunt for a sound. But what do you want to do if you're in your home, or maybe you're spending time outside or at the workplace? Take a few moments and intentionally listen for one sound, whatever that may. It might be a bird singing. It might be voices that are talking, or just sounds that we hear in nature, or the busyness of traffic, whatever that might be. But pause and think about that sound. Just focus on one thing to listen to. And in that brief few moments, that 4 or 5 minutes that you're stopping and listening, remind yourself that each one of us can continue to grow in our faith by stopping and intentionally listening to what God is saying through God's word, through a time in prayer, through conversations with others, through messages that we hear, or through things that we observe in the world around us. God continues to speak, but it's up to us to intentionally listen. And so I would encourage you to try and use this tool this week as a reminder that God has important things to say to us as individuals, because he loves us, he cares for us, and he wants to guide and help us. Amen. Let us join our hearts and voices together as we sing, "Speak, O Lord."
Take your
Amen. Please be seated. And before we come together in our time of prayer for our community, I was asked, Wynne Connolly and her family have asked me to let you know that Wynne is in hospital. And she's had some significant health setbacks in the last few months. Now, Wynne is our oldest member. She's 101 years old. And so it's hard to see someone that is always so full of life and thriving with life in a difficult spot. But Wynne is still herself. She was able to, we had a visit in the hospital this week, and doing a lot of sharing and asking questions and things, and she asked if I would sing for her. I said okay, and I was trying to think of what to sing, and she kind of leaned close to me and she said, "Well, are you going to start?" So she's still got her humor about her, bless her. I know she's expressed, the family has expressed, how much the relationship with St. John's has meant for Wynne and her family, dating back to the 1960s. So that's a long time of Christian friendship. And I know she is open to seeing some visitors. If you go, you'll probably have a shorter visit, and you'll have to listen very closely as communicating is difficult for her. But Wynne always has either something thoughtful to say, a good question to ask, or a reason to make you smile. She asked me to tell her a joke, and I told her one, and it didn't seem to go over very well. But that's okay. It's a matter of taste. But we want to continue to pray for Wynne in this time, and for her family as well. So let us come before God and pray. Loving and gracious God, we thank you for the gift of life that we can share it together, and we thank you for our dear friend Wynne, and for not just the quantity of years you continue to bless her with, but with the quality of those years as well. And we remember her today in her time of difficulty, and we pray, Lord, that you would help her to feel at peace, that you would help her to continue to know that each day that you give her has a purpose and a plan. And we thank you so much for the years of friendship she has shared and that she does share with us today, Lord. And as we rally around her and her family, Lord, bless them with strength and with peace and with helpful conversations and bless the time together that they have. Lord, we also pray for those that are close to us that have been given difficult health news this week, Lord. We pray for treatments and medications that they would be effective, that you would continue to work your miracles through modern medicine and the things that the doctors and scientists continue to discern about how to treat our physical conditions, God. And we pray for those that are trying to process the difficult news, that they would find incredible strength in you and strength in the community that surrounds us, God. Lord, we also think of those who are often with us who just feel unwell these days, and may they be blessed with strength and with healing. And for those that have gone through difficult health challenges and that are still trying to bounce back to feel like themselves, God, bless them with patience and bless them with the healing or the treatment that they need to feel like they can be more themselves each and every day. God, we think of those in the coldest parts of our country. We pray for the situation in Alberta. And as people try to combat the elements, we pray for endurance. We pray for strength, and we pray for togetherness in community, that the folks that are struggling can work together to help each other out, to stay strong against the cold. And Lord, we pray for those in Alberta and those everywhere who don't have a place to call home, who live in from place to place, Lord, and that are seeking that sense of permanence, that they be blessed with that, and that you would open doors for those that need them open the most. God, we pray all of these things, as well as the things that are on our minds about all the crisis and conflicts around the world, and offer them in our trust to you, that you hear these prayers and you answer them in your own way. The prayer is said aloud and the prayer is shared in silence. We offer them in reverent trust to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, as we go from this time of worship, and we've thought about listening and we've thought about silence, and we know that God speaks to us, and our prayer is that we would be able to put our trust in the things that we hear from God and the direction of the Holy Spirit. So let us stand together as we sing Simply Trusting Every Day. Continues to speak to us, trusting that there are words of hope and encouragement and peace and assurance and healing and forgiveness for us on our journeys each and every day. Help us to trust in God's voice and help us to tune the ears of our spirit to hear what God is saying, and that we can live out our faith in Christ each and every day. Go and be filled with the love of a God who continues to speak to us. Be filled with the peace of Christ, who speaks peace over each and every one of us. And be filled with the Holy Spirit, who guides us with word and deed each and every day. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Thank you.
still the earth below. How small the greatest gift of love the world has ever known. The fullness of the deity, a borrowed manger fills. The God of all eternity beneath the Bethlehem hills. How still he lies in Mary's arms, the long expected Christ. His voice, the raging sea. Each one at Jesus' feet.